Welcome back, RJ here, ready to get into some more training. Next up in this video series is learning about interacting and modifying products in our library. So we just finished up our last video where we learned the basics of drawing walls and room components, and also how we can prep those walls to be ready for some cabinets. Now in this video, it's time to start learning the best way that we can add those products to our projects that we're actually gonna build. Now there's a few different ways to bring in these cabinets from the library, so I'm gonna show you how to do that, along with getting familiar with some of the modifying product tools in the MicroRealm palette. The goal for us at the end of this video is to know how to add products we need for our jobs and what to do when it comes time to make changes after they've already been added to our drawing. So let's open up a new project and keep filling up our brains with more MicroVellum Toolbox. All right, let's go. Okay, so we're just keeping with the theme here and starting off with a new project. This one's going to be for testing the cabinets in our library, so we'll call it MBU Testing. Give it a job description. We'll hold off again on going into the other settings for now. Don't worry, we'll be doing plenty of that in the next few videos. Right now, I still just want you to get comfortable with figuring your way around the software and how to use what's inside this MicroVellum palette. Now a new room. And open this drawing. I like to keep things organized when I'm drawing, and it's probably a good idea for you to do something similar to your projects. The way that we're doing it in these videos might not be the best way when you're working on a real project. So you might want to do something a little different since there's going to be a lot more in the drawing than just a few cabinets from the library. But for training, I think the quadrants are working just fine, and hopefully it's making it easy for you to follow along with these exercises. So let's draw two construction lines, starting at 0, 0, 0, one in X and one in Y. Now I'm going to number them the right way this time, since in the last video I had quadrants 1 and 2 flipped and didn't even know that was the wrong way until I asked Google. So thanks, Google. Now our drawings are set up, and we can start getting to work. First, we're going to draw a set of walls in quadrant 1 so I can show you the different ways to place the products from the library. Now you should be familiar with this, so go ahead and draw two walls, both at 100 inches. Now into the Draw tab and select Draw Products. Go to the drop-down list and select from the Frameless Cabinetry category. This will be the category we're going to be working in throughout the series. But not to worry, if you're a shop that builds face frame, the things we're doing in this course will also help you just as much on knowing how to draw and make modifications to the cabinets in your library. Next up is selecting the type of cabinet. So we'll choose base cabinets, and then the base one door, our usual suspect. It's the first one on the list, so it gets picked on all the time. It's all good, it's used to it. Left-click on it, and right-click to show options. FYI, you can also double-click on that name, and the options will still appear. As you can see, we have a bunch of different things we can do from this list. For now, it's just about the ways we can get them into our drawing and put on some walls. And I know I keep talking about products on walls. This is because when it's time to do some shop drawings, Toolbox makes it real simple as long as we're working with our products the way that I'm showing you. Now, the first way we'll do this is by placing a product on the wall and selecting the anchor. Now this anchoring point is referencing the product and not the wall. Select anchor left, pick the wall you want the cabinet on. Notice how the cursor uses the left corner of the product as its base point. Now pick the corner of the wall, hit enter, and this opens the prompts of the product. Here we can make any changes we want to before it gets drawn. But for now, we're just going to keep it as is and let it go. Cool, now we got it on the wall. It's time to add another one. Go back to that same cabinet. Show the options for product placement, pick to place it on a wall, and now we'll do anchor center. Toolbox is now picking the center of the cabinet as the base point. Select the wall again, and then this midpoint. No changes in the prompts. Now, on to the next one. You guessed it, it's going to be anchor right. Same as before, selecting that wall, and now the point on the wall for the base point of this cabinet. And there we have it. The way to use anchor points to add products. And just real quick, here's an example of using the center anchor point and placing it at the end of our wall. You can see pretty clearly here how it's working. Rather than picking just the endpoints or midpoints on a wall, you can also pick a specific point or even give a dimension from a point to place your cabinet. Let's go ahead and do this together. Keep picking on our one door base. Now for the wall placement, anchor left. Pick the wall, and this time hover over the endpoint and move the cursor to the right. Be sure you have your polar tracking or ortho on, and now select this point here on the wall. So that's one way. Another way is before selecting that point, enter a value in the command line, and Toolbox will put that cabinet that amount away from the starting point. Let's put a dimension of 3. And that's how you do it. Go ahead and make sure that's where we want it by pulling a dimension, and that looks good. Now that leads us into the next method of adding products. So we'll move over to quadrant 2 and start with a couple more walls, this time using a polyline. The first one is drawn at left to right at 100, and the next one is going to start on the right and go to the left. Now I know I said this is the wrong way to do it, but if there's a situation where you want the products to be facing the opposite direction, this is how it's done. I like to think of it as if I'm standing in front of the wall and looking at the cabinets. Now let's go to draw room components and draw the walls by picking the two polyline paths. This is going to be the one that will have the cabinets facing the opposite direction. Now to add products from the library. This time we'll choose something different. Let's use the tall one door. Again, select and right click or double click, whatever you like. And pick fill wall with products. This one is great if you have a run with a bunch of the same cabinets. You can tell Toolbox how much it needs to be away from the left and the right side. And then depending on the quantity you want, Toolbox does the math for you and fills up that wall. The prompts that open up here will be for all the cabinets that are about to be drawn. So unless you want something on for each one of them, you can just hit OK and have them draw with the default and project level properties. If you need to, you can always go back into them and make any other changes you want. Now we have a wall full of cabinets, and by doing it one of the ways we just went through, you can be certain that the products are going to be associated to these walls. And on to the next one. Here we're going to see what happens when we fill up this wall with cabinets. Doing it the same way, with the same cabinet, the tall one door. And there we have the cabinets facing 180 degrees because of the way that we originally drew this wall. Next up, quadrant 3. Now we're going to continue adding more cabinets from the library. This time we'll use some uppers. Let's start off by laying out some walls with a couple more polylines. Make sure we have them drawn in the way that we want the cabinets to be placed. The lengths of each segment are going to be 100 inches. Now let's add the walls from the microvellum palette. And this image here is what we're going to want to draw. So we need to go find our upper two door in the upper cabinets category. And we're going to fill up this wall with cabinets again, but we need to make sure we're leaving enough room at the end for the run on the adjacent wall. This will be our upper depth plus enough for a corner filler. Update the quantity until the width is what you want and hit OK to draw. Leave the prompts alone again on this one. And now we have some uppers filling up the space we need. Now just more rinse and repeat. Do the same thing to the other wall. This one is just going to have a little bit more distance at the end. Moving over to the other set of walls and adding more cabinets here. When we do this, you can see again that they're being placed on the correct side of the wall based on how we drew that polyline. For the next wall, we'll switch it up a little and use the anchor point of the cabinet again. Select anchor left and then the wall. Now hover your cursor over the corner of the wall. Slowly drag your mouse over and type a value of 16. Enter. And now that cabinet is placed at 16 inches away from that corner. Let's go back into our library and we'll pick on the upper one door glass door cabinet this time. And instead of placing it on the wall, we'll choose to place it next to another product. Now, because this cabinet we're placing it next to is already associated to this wall, Toolbox knows that we want this one to also be associated to the same wall. Now, what doesn't work is when placing it at a selected point. When we do that, there's no way for Toolbox really to know whether it's supposed to be on that wall or not. I'm going to repeat the same method as the last and draw another upper two door next to that glass door. One other method I wanted to show you was filling the space on a wall with cabinets. So I'm just going to demonstrate this one real quick. But when you go back through and do some practice, set up a wall with a space to draw some cabinets and try out this method. So if I have this amount of space to work with, I can use the fill wall with products again. And instead of using the distance from each side, I can pick 2 points and give a quantity of products to be drawn. Double checking with the dimension. Remember, escape is the way to cancel any command. Okay, now we're going to go back into quadrant 2 and work on making some modifications to those cabinets. Let's get to know how to use some of the tools under the Modify tab in Modify Products. First to the prompts and update the width of this tall one door. We'll make it a little bit smaller. 18, that'll work for me. Now, what if we need to get rid of this one cabinet and use a smaller base cabinet instead? We need to start by erasing the tall and placing the new base cabinet next to the existing. We'll double-click in the cell to give us the width that we need. And now we have a base cabinet. But what about changing the sizes again and then having to change the location of some of those cabinets? We can use our Modify tools to make that easy. I'll adjust the width of this base cabinet to make it a little bit smaller than the opening. And now the best way to move a cabinet to make sure that it's still on the wall and next to another one is the bump product command. Select the cabinet you want to move and then the one you want to bump to. Let's do that again to the next one. And there it is. So super easy and my go-to when I need to shift some cabinet locations. Now moving on to the other run of cabinets. With this one, we're going to erase a couple cabinets, add a new one, and move them around using the microvellum move command. First, erase the ones that we don't want. Before we draw the new base cabinet, we need to give ourselves some room. Let's see what we're working with. Check that dimension. Okay, and now for the microvellum move command from the palette, select the cabinet. Pick a base point in this open space here. Now move your mouse to the left, type 5, and hit enter. Now there's plenty of room for a 24-inch cabinet. So we'll go to draw products and select a new base 2-door to draw. Place it next to another. Give it a new width and let it draw. Let's do the bump product command again to move this right next to the other. And then the move command to shift them all down this wall. Again, this is the microvellum move from the palette. First, select the products to move, then a base point. So the base point doesn't necessarily have to be on the product. In this situation, because we're telling these cabinets to move a specific amount, it can really be anywhere inside of the space. Now move the cursor in the direction you want to move the products and give it a value of 10. Enter, and that's it. Let's do the move command one more time. This time it'll be from a base point on the product. Select the three products, enter, and now the base point. And then with polar tracking on, select the next point. I still have my 3D object snap turned off to be sure that I'm not snapping to a point that will make these cabinets end up in some weird location. So it might be a good idea just to go ahead and double check to make sure yours is still off too. As we change the view, you can see here everything looks good. No base cabinets or anything sitting on top of these walls. So I'm happy. Now moving back to quadrant 3, I want to go over how to copy a product you already have drawn in Toolbox. So let's erase this upper 2-door using the microvellum erase command. Yes, I'm sure. Now the copy product command. First pick the product, then enter, then the base point, and now the second point of displacement. Double check to make sure it's in the right spot. And now we have our copy product. Go ahead and finish up this run with the tall cabinet to cap off the end. Now for the last part of this video, I want to focus on some of the things you can do with these products through the product prompts page. Let's get another wall drawn and place a product in the center. Isolate these objects. And now let's take a look at things you can do to modify this cabinet. Add a couple fillers, turn off the countertop. Now this is a prompt that doesn't always have to be turned off at this local level. you can have it set up as a project property and not have a countertop drawn with each cabinet. Same goes for the other construction and advanced options you see below. Those prompts can also be on all the time if you want. And we're going to learn how to do all that before we get too far along with more projects. Okay, so now I'm just going to go through and make a bunch of other changes to this cabinet, and you can see how it behaves. Notice again, as some prompts turn on, others appear. As I orbit around, you can see how all these changes are taking effect. Now, one thing that is very important to remember is that a lot of these prompts are controlled at the project level. So if you want all your products in this project to have the same door to cabinet gap or top reveal, do it at the project level inside of the project wizard or global variables, instead of having to do all the work in each product or the local level. The sign to look for if a prompt is controlled at the project level is that the value will be in red. Now let's check the box to add fascia. And for any of you confused about the prompt name add fascia, you're not alone. You can think of it basically just like adding a false front. So add fascia might as well just say add false front. Now red means that it has a formula behind it driving the data that you see here next to the prompt name. Typically if it's red, you don't want to change it at the local level, but if it's only one or two cabinets, it's going to be just fine. So we can make some of the changes here and see how the parts in the cabinet adjust accordingly. Depending on where you are in the world, some of these names you see here could be slightly different than what you're used to. I'm just going to continue to go through and make some more changes. Go under the drawer options tab to adjust the properties of the drawers. And the hardware tab lets you select different hardware than the one being used for the entire project. Now to finish this up, let's go through each quadrant and renumber all these products. Since we already have 101 through 103, we'll start with 104 and finish up renumbering all these products. Enter how the first number will be called out. Be sure you're using a decimal. Then from there, depending on how you have the item number set up in Toolbox Options, Toolbox will go through and renumber the products as you go around selecting each item number. When done, repeat the command and start with a new set of numbers. Now we'll just number this last one 401. And that brings us to the end of this video. So I hope that helped wrapping your head around how the products behave when changing properties and how they should be placed on walls so that they're ready for the next phase of the drafting process. Great job on making it through another one. Keep up the good work, and I'll see you in the next video.